Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Welcome to this C401 Water Resources Engineering 14th class. So far, 12 classes we have seen the basic hydrology, fundamental processes happening in hydrological cycle. If you have understood that hydrological processes thoroughly, then water resources engineering will be an easy subject. Hydrological processes or hydrology, as if we are not doing anything there, we are just observing the natural phenomena happening spatially and temporally and try to record it and then try to analyze it. That is what we have done in hydrology. But what is the use of observation of such hydrological processes? The main thing is the important input for all living beings in this world is water, next to air. But the availability of water varies in large, spatially as well as temporally. So in order to make it uniform to all, we need to suppress this problem of spatial and temporal water availability. How we can do? First, we can analyze the observed hydrological processes. The second is developing several infrastructure, right, called as hydraulic infrastructure or water resources infrastructure, which will reduce this temporal water availability, and then design a proper water distribution system, either a canal network or a pipe network system, so that you can transfer the water from one space to another space. Out of all the infrastructure, water infrastructure, dam, construction of a dam is one of the dream of several hydraulic engineers, because dam is a massive structure which tries to impound a huge quantity of water behind that structure, and it gives major benefit, right? One of the major benefit. So that is why several people try to study this dam engineering in detail, acquire knowledge. But please remember, it is not just the knowledge of water resources engineer alone is sufficient to construct the dam. It's a multidisciplinary subject. So a person who is excelling himself in dam design should excel in all related subjects in civil engineering. If it is a powerhouse, then electrical engineering. If you have machines there, mechanical engineering. So basically, you should be an all-rounder in all engineering subjects if you want to master this dam engineering. Let us see what is this dam, right? I think we have seen several pictures so far on hydraulic dams. Dams are hydraulic structure constructed across a river to store water in its upstream side, that is behind the dam. That means when there is a quantity of water flowing in the river and there is a demand, if that water flowing in the river is always more than the demand, then I don't need an elaborate structure to store the water and then distribute. But if that water flowing in the river, some periods the quantity of water flowing is large, and some periods called as lean period, the quantity of water flowing is less than the demand. That means there is no temporal distribution of uniform water availability throughout the period. So in such cases, we need to store the water which is flowing during excess period so that you can use it during lean period. And such structures are called as hydraulic structure, which will reduce the temporal water availability problem. Canal network, pipe net distribution networks are to suppress the spatial water availability. So then what happens after a construction of the dam? A dam is an obstruction in the flow of the river with suitable outlets for various purposes, starting from environmental flow, this minimum flow, fish ladder, irrigation, drinking water, right? So many other auxiliary infrastructures. After construction of the dam, after obstructing the flow, the water level in the river on the upstream side increases. Once it is more than the level of the river bed and river width, then it inundates the adjoining area and it will flood or it will be stored in the land adjacent to the river. And such storage of water is called as reservoir. There are several uses of this water, right? Out of all, the major is irrigation. In India, it is irrigation. In other countries, it is for drinking water. United Nations also says that now drinking water supply is the first priority in the agenda. That is, drinking water and sanitation is the first priority. Then irrigation requirement. If the dam height is sufficient, then you can produce clean energy, also called as hydroelectric power. And sometimes it may be used for navigation, recreational purposes, right? Several other purposes. That is the use of dam. So these are all some of the uses. Sometimes you can use it for flood control, navigation, hydroelectric power, right? Recreation water, drinking water, irrigation, right? These are all some of the figures which will keep you remember what are all the purpose of a dam or construction of the dam, right? When the dam is constructed across the river, right, from one bank to another bank, and there is a good foundation available at the bottom, then we will see what are all the different types of dams. When I cut this dam at across the length, right, these are all the components I can see. This is the dam, and the tapering part is called downstream side of the dam, and the vertical portion is upstream side where water gets stagnated. Once water gets stagnated, the water level rises slowly, right? And there are different storages. We have seen in runoff chapter how to estimate the life storage or the useful storage of the reservoir. So this goes on increasing, or sometimes it may go above the useful level, that is called as flood storage. We have to give provision for flood storage. These are all components, right? The dam at bottommost rests on a good foundation. The upper upstream side corner, bottommost, is called as the heel, and this is called as the toe. It's like a body of the structure, right? And there is a gallery opening from one bank to another bank for two purposes. This is happen only in solid gravity structures, right? It may not be possible in earthen dams, concrete, stone masonry. The purpose is for inspection to check whether any leakages are there. Second one is to collect the seeped water through the body of the dam and drain it away. And then you will have a sluice for release of the water stored, and the topmost water surface which surpluses or which escapes from the dam, the surplus water, is called as spillway. It is simply a cross section of a dam, right? These are all the terminology of the dams which we have seen now. Heel, right? So abutments are the two sides where the dam rests across the valley. Galleries are openings from one bank to another bank through the body of the dam, right? Diversion tunnels are nothing but the construction of, before construction of the dam, water is always flowing. Suppose if you are constructing the dam in a perennial river system, then always water is flowing. So you need to divert that flow of water to the downstream side without washing off construction of the dam site, and that is possible through coffer dams. Sometimes if coffer dam is not possible, then we can do this diversion tunnels through the mountain abutting on the valley, right? Spillway is the surplus arrangement. Sluice gate is the opening through which you draw the water for use for them. Okay. Now, before going into the dams, hydraulic dams, let us see what are all the different types of their dams. The dams are classified based on three important matter. First one is based on their function, right? Second one is based on their hydraulic design, and then based on materials used for construction. Now let us see, based on their function. Function means use. For what purpose you are constructing the dam? 90% of the dams we construct mainly to store the water. So such dams are called as storage dams. They are very large. Their water used may be for multi-purpose. Okay. They are all storage dams. Second type of dams is diversion dams. Here in this case, water is always flowing in the river. I may not construct a huge dam. We will just construct a obstruction which will eventually raise the water level in the river. And then from the river there will be a canal network. So the water will get diverted into the canals. Examples are weirs and barrages or diversion dams. Retention dams is to store more water during floods and release it gradually so that the downstream side will not get affected. People used to club these two, storage and detention dams, together, and the volume of water stored in such dams is, first one is useful storage, the second one is flood storage, the third is dead storage. We will see what it is. So three types of storages combined together. This is based on their function. Then based on material of construction, right? What material you use to construct the obstruction or to create the obstruction? Depending upon the material used, there are two types. One is called rigid dams, second one is non-rigid dams. And you know, rigid dams are the material which will not get dissolved in the water, right? Like constructed using rigid material. Like concrete, and we call that as a concrete gravity dam, masonry dam, steel, timber. Steel and timber, they have less life. So most of the dams we are constructing either concrete or masonry. The second type is non-rigid dams. That means it may be possible that the dam get dissolved in the water, like earthen dams, rock filled dams with proper protections. This is a good example, right? This dam on the top corner, this is a concrete dam, gravity dam, Mettur dam, and this is stone masonry, Pechiparai, and these are all earthen dams, stone pitched, right? Upstream and downstream are covered with stone pitch. Inside it is purely earthen material, right? Based on hydraulics. What is hydraulics here? The gates, the surplus here. Gates are there on every dam. But depending upon how you are disposing the excess water from upstream to downstream, there are two types. One is non-overflow dam, another one is overflow dams. Non-overflow dam means, this is a good example. This is Periyar Dam in Thekkady. The water will not flow over the dam or flow from this dam site, but there will be a separate arrangement to take away the excess water, right? That is called non-overflow dam. Here you can say that overflow dam, once the water level goes beyond certain useful storage level, the excess water will flow through the surplus weir. And in this overflow dam also, there are two. One is gated, another one is non-gated. That means here the one figure, this is a non-gated. As the water level goes above this weir, it surpluses. In this case, by operating the gate, you can still store some quantity of flood water. Right? This is based on the hydraulic design. Right? So this is a good example. Right? The second one is, the hydraulic consideration is, how this load is transferred. See, when you store the water, right, behind the structure, the dam will act like a cantilever. right? Because it is attached with the earth, and both the ends are hinged with an earthen bund. And now this, if I take a cross section, it is like a, go back to this, it is like a cantilever, right? Here it is the water, it is fixed here at the bottom, and now this is the load, from zero load at the top and maximum load near the foundation. So it acts as a cantilever. So then how it transfers that load to the earth, right? The first one is the load acting on the dam is transferred to the earth through its self weight, or the external load acting on the dam are counteracted by the self weight of the dam. Such dams are called as gravity dam. Okay, so gravity dams are mostly straight, and their cross section is like shown in the triangular. Basic shape is triangular. There will be a tapering on the downstream side. So I think this picture which is shown here, this is nothing but Bakra Dam, right, the modern temple of India. The portion where water is stored is called as upstream side or the reservoir. This is downstream side. So we have a tapering on the downstream side. So the load is transferred through the earth by its self weight. Such dams are called as gravity dam. Most of the earthen dams are gravity dams. The second one, when the load acting on the dam is transferred to the abutments, when you have a strong abutment, then such dams are called as arch dams. Because in arch, the moment at any cross section except at the bunds or abutments will be zero. So then what happens? You no need a large cross section to counteract the forces acting on the dam. So the structure will be thin. The material used for construction will be thin, but for this you must have a strong abutments. Then when the load is counteracted by the buttress action or a support at the downstream side, that is called buttress dam. So these are all three different types of dams, how they counteract the load acting on the dam. Right? So this is the explanation. It depends upon its own weight for stability. Generally trapezoidal section, the design basic structure is triangular, but when you construct the top portion, it becomes trapezoidal. An earthen bund is always a trapezoidal section with a straight base. The advantage is it is very simple in analysis and structural behavior. It does not require high degree of materials. Even earthen material is sufficient to construct a gravity dam. This is a good example. This is the forces acting on the dam. The major force acting on the dam is water force. We will see the details, right? Water force. And this force is counteracted or taken to the earth by its self weight, right? This is an example, spelling mistake. Example of gravity dam, the Bakra Dam. Right? You can see this, it is 740 feet height. Above the deepest foundation, it's a straight concrete dam, right? The length on top is almost 518 meters. The width is 190 meters, okay? So this is example for buttress gravity dam. Buttress dams are also gravity, but mostly the support in the downstream side is also provided, right? This is arch dam. Right. Arch dams are mostly curved in cross section as well as from the plan. If there are two types of arch dams, one is in only in the plan it is curved, whereas in cross section it is a straight line. Then the other type of arch dam is in cross section also it is a curve and the top is also a curve. For example, you have a cup and saucer, right? You have a tea saucer. Right, it's a plate. You break it exactly off, right, and keep it in top also it is curved, and in cross section also it is curved. That is called as double arch dams, right? An arch dam example. You can see from the plan the shape of the dam. The plan is a curved one, right? then we will see that in detail. Then this is an earthen dam, a trapezoidal shape. This is called upstream of the dam and this is downstream side of the dam where water goes. So it is constructed with locally available earth material. But if the seepage is too much, then what happens? The central portion is filled with a material whose permeability is less than the permeability of the material outside it. That is called as rock filled dam, which will reduce the seepage flow. Okay, that is earthen dams and rock filled dam. So before going into the other types of structure, let us see what are all the major forces acting on a dam, right? We all know that the major force acting on the dam is water force, right? That is called as hydrostatic pressure. The second one is the water which is stored for a large height. Just keep quiet, even though we call that as a static water, it starts seeping below the foundation and try to lift this dam from the bottom. And such force is called as uplift pressure or uplift force. The third one is when there is an earthquake. The earthquake happens in all 360 degree and then there the water will get an induced pressure. That's hydrodynamic pressure. And that also will act on this earth. And if the dam is situated in a cold region, the top portion will get solid, solidified. When it is a solid, and this solid will act like a point load at the end of the cantilever, right? You just tilt this dam, this will be a fixed end, and this is a uniformly varying load, water force. And when there is ice, that will act as a point load at the top. When water is stored on the backside, depending upon the area and wind speed, the water level will not be a still one. There will be a formation of wave. And this wave pressure is function of wind speed and also called as fetch of the dam. Fetch is the longest distance of the water stored from the face of the upstream to the shore. So that is, that wave will also act on the face of the dam and that is called as wave pressure. But when you are stopping this water, what happens? Huge quantity of sediments, silt, get deposited at the bottom. So once these sediments are deposited, they are mixed with water, then they become like a slurry. And this also will act at the bottom of the dam, that is called as silt pressure. These are all some of the major forces acting on the dam. So all these forces are counteracted by its self-weight. And sometimes what happens, people deliberately store some quantity of water at the downstream side of the dam to counteract these forces. Right? That is called as tailwater pressure. We will see one by one in detail. Right? First is self-weight of the dam. This is a major resisting force. How to estimate this numerically? First, find out what is the material which it is constructed. You know what is the specific weight of the material. Then, in the cross section, find the cross sectional area, converting that into different rectangles and triangles. Then, find the weight of each component and multiply it with the specific weight that will give you the force acting on the earth from this dam. Second one is hydrostatic pressure. When I consider this, the hydrostatic pressure, the pressure at top of the dam, water level zero, the pressure is also zero. As the pressure increases or the depth increases, the pressure also increases. The pressure, water pressure will be maximum at the bottom of the dam, which is equal to, right? So the horizontal water pressure is gamma H, right? Specific weight into height. And the total force acting on this due to acting on the dam due to this pressure is called as hydrostatic force, which is equal to the area of this triangular half into base into height. Half base is WH, or the height of the water stored. Again, the triangle bottom base is H, so it is WHL square by 2. And this acts at an height of H by 3 from the bottom. So this is called as water pressure. This same pressure acts at the heel as the uplift pressure, right? Because the force due to which is just entering the heel of below the heel of the dam is also WH1. So then at the downstream side, if there is no water, it becomes zero. Otherwise, the pressure is WH2. Then make a trapezoidal. So one base is WH1, another base is WH2, and this distance between heel and toe is the height. So then estimate this area, and which acts as 1/3 of this length. That is the weight at which pressure at which this WU, that is uplift pressure, acts. But when I provide a gallery, right, or a opening throughout the cross section of the dam from one bank to another bank, in the name of gallery, all the seepage water comes to this gallery. So there is a reduction in uplift pressure. That is why there are two diagrams. One is this trapezoidal, another one is at below the gallery, the uplift pressure reduces. So the total force due to uplift also gets reduced. The silt pressure is also multiply the specific gravity of the silt and the height of the silt deposited, that will become silt pressure. Now let us see what is this, right? This is uplift pressure, trapezoidal, right? Area of this triangular, WH1 is at the heel of the dam, WH2 is at toe of the dam, right? The total force acting is area of this. A is the length between heel and toe. Right? A is the area of the base of the dam. The second one is earthquake pressure. Due to the earthquake, primary and secondary waves are set. These waves impart acceleration to the foundation under the dam, right, which provides inertia. The worst combination is combination of earthquake pressure and water pressure when the dam is full. That is the maximum force that will hit the dam. So through the earthquake may travel in any direction. It is usual to resolve acceleration at horizontal and vertical. So the vertical force is not linear like your water pressure. It is a non-linear, and that is function of my acceleration coefficient. And this acceleration coefficient varies from zone to zone. Like in India, we have 4 seismic zones, and its value varies between 0.1 to 0.2, right? So my inertia force due to acceleration along with water force and uplift force is the worst combination of design of dam. And this is not linear, it's a non-linear force acting from top of the dam to bottom of the dam. Right, this is von Karman's equation. The area of that is pressure intensity due to acceleration, EI. Then the total force acting on the earth dam is called hydrodynamic pressure due to earthquake. According to Wonman, is 0.55 times of acceleration coefficient into specific weight of water and height of water stored. And it acts as 4/3 of H1 and pi, because it is part of a circle. The last one is ice pressure, important for dams constructed in cold countries and also due to thermal expansions, right? There are certain standards for it.